हैप्पी न्यू ईयर भाई, आज की आप मतलब कैप्टन तो संजोग का और ट्रांसमिशन ऑफ साइंस कर रहा था। शुरू विद अ वेरी डिस्टिंग्विश्ड कॉन्टेक्ट अर्नेस मेटर फिजिसिस ऑन द लीडिंग फिजिसिस इन इंडिया एंड ऑल्सो वेरी वेल नोन डूइंग द डिग्री पीएचडी फ्रॉम मैरिलैंड एंड देन वाज पोस्ट डॉक इन ईयर एंड टोरंटो एंड इज रिसिपिएंट ऑफ मेनी अवार्ड इंक्लूडिंग द भटनागर अवार्ड ऑल्सो द मेंबर ऑफ अकेडमी ऑफ साइंसेस इज नोन टू बी अ एक्सलेंट टीचर ऑल ऑफ अस So, we are very happy that you agreed to visit us, although for a short period, and we do want you to come for a long period, possibly, until you teach us parts of management of physics. That will be great for us. So, welcome.
Transport in deduct materials. So the basic purpose of this talk is to introduce this class of materials whose low energy quasi particles follow a different equation, is described by a different equation than the standard Schrodinger equation that we know in condensed matter physics. It follows, it has the same mathematical structure of a Dirac equation, which was formulated long time back by Dirac in the context of relativistic field theory. So, and the examples of this kind of materials we all probably know are graphene, that's the most prominent example, and then another class. There is no syllabus here, right? I don't have to finish everything that I put on the slide. So, here is graphene. So, graphene comes from graphite, which is a 3D allotrope of carbon, which is most commonly found in pencil tips. Okay, so the moment you see your pencil tip, that's graphite for you. So it's one of the most stable form of carbon with weak interplanar coupling. And it has very anisotropic properties. And one of the persons who first found these anisotropic properties and did really nice experiments on this was K.S. Krishnan in the 40s. And his work was really well noted at that point. So the anisotropic properties involves the following thing, that these are good propagators. So it has good propagation of both phonons and electrons in plane, and therefore are good thermal and electrical conductor. However, in the along the c-axis, the conduction is really poor, both electrical and thermal conduction. And the reason is that the bonds along this c-axis has a different properties compared to bonds in plane. Now, graphene is a single layer of this graphite. So the structure of this is this quasi two-dimensional structure. So you have these hexagonal planes with carbon atoms sitting at the edges of this hexagon. There is one such layer. It's connected to the next layer by weak bonds, and connected to the next layer by weak bonds, and so on. Okay? There's a stacked set of planes. Each plane is a hexagonal structure. Now, if you could have isolated, and that's what Geim and others did, one layer of this graphite, that's what we call graphene. Okay? Now, experimental separation of graphene has been a long-standing challenge. You know, and part of it came from a theorem which said that there is no free 2D structure which is going to stay flat. You know, it's supposed to roll and bend and form a 3D structure because of its because of fluctuations, thermal fluctuations. However, of course, this happens for a completely free 2D structure. This is, of course, on some substrate, and that doesn't apply. But there are many theoretical and experimental problems, or you know, challenges that one had to sort of overcome to get this thing. And the way this was done was the following. So it was done by something we call the Scotch tape technique. So there is a very interesting anecdote in this. So Andre Geim in his laboratory essentially had some very hardworking student. Chinese student who was okay, who was given this task of taking a graphite sample and then cleaving it so as to reach at least a few layers of graphite. So 1 month into this project, or maybe a few months into this project, the student came back and told Geim that, you know, this cannot be done. I could reach a few hundred layers, but beyond that, it's impossible. So Geim, of course, you know, the way people talk, to their graduate students, just said that, well, why don't you go back and try some more? It's exactly what we tell our students when they come after a long calculation with no results whatsoever. So this student essentially asked Grime, well, why don't you try it? You know, Grime actually took up that challenge. He started this cleaving thing, and he found out that the student was absolutely right. This cannot be the way of getting this thing. But he, what he found is that every time you polish this graphite, and essentially what you do is that you polish the surface with a scotch tape, and then you take this tape and throw it out. So what Gaim did is to look at this tape very carefully, and he said that while polishing, there are some very thin flakes of graphite, which comes and gets stuck to this tape. So he examined some of this under the microscope, and luckily, and due to some properties of graphite, this single layer stuff is could be seen by microscope because of some optical property which is different for single layer than multi layers. And he found a few single layer samples, and that's one of those things. You know, this light blue area is essentially a graphene sample on a substrate. And then what he did is to isolate one of them, put some gates, and did some experiment. And that was the first paper, essentially, which started the field. So he noted that our graphene films were prepared by mechanical exfoliation, repeated peeling of small mesas, some structure, of highly oriented pyrolytic graphite. And this approach was found to be highly reliable and allowed us to prepare these films 10 micrometer in size. And so that was how graphene was sort of given. Yeah, go ahead. That's right. So when you peel, even when cleaving, you can cleave because the interlayer coupling is really weak, you know, so you can sort of do that. Now there are a lot, actually. Silicin, tannin, phosphorin, all of this essentially has the same property. I mean, but most of these essentially are gapped materials. You know, there is a gap. This one is not. Sorry. And that's the main this thing about graphene. So look at that. No. He just worked on graphite. 3D this thing. In 40s, this was unthinkable, actually. You know, you really didn't have the technology to do this. That's right. That's right. Yeah. So I'm going to come to that, actually. Right. So here is the thing. Okay. So in carbon, when you have this graphene or graphite, rather, each unit cell has two electrons from 2pz orbitals leading to, you have sp2 hybridization here. That's basic chemistry. So this sp2, so when you bring two of these, this sp2 stuff hybridizes to form the sigma bond, whereas the pz orbitals, which are left out, you know, they form the pi bond. And when you basically bring lot of them together, this pi bond essentially forms what is called the pi band. And all of the electronic properties of graphene comes from this pi band, which actually contributes this low energy electrons to them. So from a physicist's point of view, the way to look into this is a bunch of electrons hopping on a honeycomb lattice. Okay, so these electrons come from some complicated band structure, but which comes from this ab initio calculations. But the point is, at the end of the day, you can always write down an effective tight binding model. And by that, what I mean is that each electron on a given site has a kinetic energy term, which is described by the process of that hopping from a site to the next nearest neighbor. Okay. So that's the kinetic energy model. Yeah.
So,
how long do you have the correlation length?
So you see, in benzene, when you have this kind of stuff, the standard, if you take this Pauling's idea of this, you know, that's looking at it from the strong coupling point. So these are really strongly interacting layers. In graphene, I'm going to talk about interaction, but it turns out that most of the properties are well described by your internalized particle type of behavior, which means that you can look at it from a band theory perspective. So it's a, just a fact.
So just a renormalized mass energy.
Yeah, exactly. So I'm just going to come to that. Just see few months. So the point, yeah, sorry, go ahead.
No,
well, if you were looking into properties of the edges, yeah, it's like an armchair kind of very important property.
But actually, in experiment generally, is it always that you get this phase?
No, but in experiment, when you do a standard bulk transport, the edge contribution is minuscule. It's just a phase space argument. The 2D bulk is going to contribute much more, or much more to the 1D. You have to be really doing special things to look into that edge more than calculating transport or any other thing. So the point is that the interesting thing about this honeycomb lattice is that there are two equivalent sites. And what I mean by that is that look at this A site, out here, this particular site. The surroundings of this forms a Y. You could see that, you know, there is a Y structure up there. Whereas this site, immediately below it, the surrounding of this forms an inverted Y. So from a crystallographic point of view, these two sites are individual. Okay, that's basic crystallographic value. So since there are these two sites are equivalent, one can talk about probability of an electron to be on an A site or a B site. And this can be thought as the up and down state of some fictitious field. So if the electron wave function is completely localized on A site,
you say that it's in a pseudo spin up state. So it's not really a spin, but it's almost like a spin because it's a two state thing. So you say that it's in a pseudo spin up state. Whereas if it is completely localized in B site, you say that it's a pseudo spin down state. Okay, so this is a jargon in the graphene community where they say that, you know, this AB sublattice structure is essentially talked about in terms of pseudo spin. And you can write down a two component wave function, psi A and psi B, where these two essentially gives you the probability amplitude of an electron being on the A site or a B site. Okay, so that's the jargon that graphene follows. Now the point is that, once you have such a tight binding model, you know, the physicists have a way of tackling this. So the kinetic energy of these electrons are essentially some hopping terms. So what it does is that it starts from a given A site, let's say, it hops to the next possible site. But look that if it starts from an A site out here, the hopping is always to some B site, right? And if it starts from a B site, the nearest neighbor hopping is always to an A site. And therefore, in the language where the electron wave function is determined by a two component stuff, psi A and psi B, the hopping is off diagonal. Because it always goes from one site to the next and so on. And the way to do this is some physicist trick, and I don't want to get into the details of this, it's just a Fourier transformation. So once you have this hopping stuff, what you do is that you go to momentum space, and then you have a 2x2 matrix, in case of graphene, this H of K is very well known. And you can calculate by diagonalizing this 2x2 matrix, the energy dispersion. Since this is a 2x2 matrix, there are two energy bands, and the plus band is called the conduction band, and the minus band is called the valence band. And graphene, if it is absolutely pristine graphene and you haven't gated it and doped it or done anything to it, then all the electrons in the valence band all the states in the valence band are filled, and all the states in the conduction band is empty. That's just the state of pristine graphene. Coming to that. So in the next slide, what I want to do is to plot these two bands. And the band structure looks just like this, okay? So you see that, and here is the unique thing about graphene. So you see that if I had a two-dimensional material, right? So if I had a three-dimensional material, what do I have? So if I start filling up my electron states, and if it's a metal, at some level I have a Fermi surface, right? Which tells me that all the states below the surface is filled and all the states above it is empty. Now this Fermi surface for a three-dimensional material forms a two-dimensional surface in the momentum space, right? Because it's a solution of epsilon k equal to some constant which we call as the Fermi energy. And therefore it gives you an equation for. However, so by the same logic, you would have expected a Fermi line in two dimensions. Because again, it's a two-dimensional surface, you fill up your stuff and you would expect that, you know, everything vanishes along. Now the unique thing about graphene is from the band structure, what follows is that the valence and the conduction band touch at isolated points on the Brillouin zone and not along a line. So you see that around this is what you have these bands touching. It doesn't touch here, for example. Now, and it does touch at the edge of the graphene Brillouin. So, and it turns out that out of these 6 points, only 2 are inequivalent. The rest can be reached from, you can go from one point to another by some capital G, which is a lattice vector in momentum space, okay? So there are these just 2 points which are inequivalent, and we call them K and K prime points in graphene. These are 2 of these points. Now, the point is that if I now sort of expand around this and zoom around this particular point, one of these touching points, you find that the energy dispersion around this is linear. And because I have still have this A and B sublattice index, I need a 2-component wave function to discuss this. And that is all it takes to have a Dirac theory in 2 dimensions, linear dispersion and a 2x2 matrix structure. Because Dirac matrices in 2D are just sigma matrices, okay? So that's the Pauli matrix. So essentially, that's the origin of why Dirac physics comes in graphene. The low energy property is described by an effective Dirac-like theory. Okay, is that clear? So here are some jargons. Essentially, forget about this, I won't be needing it. So the terminology is that the pseudo spin, you know, that's the probability amplitude on the A and the B sublattice. That's described by a Pauli matrix sigma. Now, you also have a 2x2 matrix associated with the 2 points where the graphene's, this bands touch. Now, these are the K and K prime point, and these are called valleys. And then, of course, there is the real physical spin. And if you sort of expand this Hamiltonian around any of these points, and after all the dust settles and you have done your calculation, it turns out that it's really a sigma x kx plus sigma y ky kind of term. So it's sigma dot k, which is the typical Dirac Hamiltonian in 2 dimensions. Sorry?
Y.
In 2 dimensions, it's Dirac. In 3D, it would be y. Okay. And so the idea is that this particular, and this sigma is this pseudo spin, that is this AB amplitude, which plays the role of the Dirac spinner here. Yeah, VF is the effective Fermi velocity around the point where you are expanding. So that's, so now if I imagine, no, it matters. This tau 3 tells you that in one case you have a plus sign here, and the other case you have a minus sign. For K stuff, it has a plus, and for K prime, it has a minus. So that's the only difference. VF is same in both cases. So, and there is the fact that there is no large momentum scattering. If you don't have a large momentum scattering, then this is like 2 species of massless Dirac fermion, one localized around K's point and the other localized around K prime point. Okay. Spin, no. Each of these species can have up and down spins. Okay, so the real spin is not described by sigma. So, yeah. So it can have both up and down spins. So just think of it as 2 copies, one with up spin and one with down spin. No, it doesn't contribute. But in case,
for example, if you want to study how magnetic impurities interact with this, then you have to do the full theory with real spins and all that. That can be done.
So if I ask that rare, so because of this number of degrees of freedom, it's 2. So
it has to be 2, right? It cannot be 1. Because a single Dirac cone is, you have this Noble theorem.
But fermionic structure is the minus. Why there is a minus sign coming? Fermionic structure is
here.
So is this true that if I exchange them, I mean, in the space of this pseudo spin, why is a fermion?
It's a fermion because you are starting with electrons. No, that's why it's fermion. Okay? And
this pseudo spin is not a real spin.
Pseudo spin is not a real spin. It's just your probability amplitude of having something on A and something on B.
Or say K and K prime.
No, K and K prime is the valley index. That's completely different.
Okay.
So this sigma is essentially around these 2. Like, so you see, your unit cell is comprised of 2 points, A and B. So you have a two-component wave function. And that's why it's a spinner. It's a pseudo spinner, so to speak. And that's this sigma out here. Is that clear? So here are some properties. I'm going to talk about this helicity a bit later, so let me ignore it right now. So what happens is that this Fermi, so for twisting graphene, this Fermi energy is exactly at zero. That's at the Dirac point. However, you can dope it very easily, and then it fills up and forms the Fermi surface. And the interesting part about this is that if you calculate the density of state, that is the number of states available to put the electrons, it goes as some rho naught times mod E plus EF. But EF is this Fermi energy, okay? And E is the energy at which, energy at which you calculate this density of state. So you see that as you approach this Dirac point, the density of state vanishes linearly. Mm-hmm. Okay, because EF is zero, and as you tune your energy to the Dirac point, which is at E equal to zero, this vanishes linearly. And that is why graphene is typically called a semi-metal, pristine metal, because it's a metal, because it doesn't have a gap. But it's almost an insulator, because you really don't have enough states to do anything with your points. This is literally, it's very different from a standard metal, because for standard metal, density of state is just a constant around the Fermi. So that's the difference. Okay, so ignore all these things, but let me just tell you what I wanted to do. So in graphene now, you can think of how strongly interacting this thing is. You know, there is an estimate. Now this estimate is very simple. Graphene is a Dirac type of material, right? Now, in quantum electrodynamics, when you estimate the strength of interaction induced by photons, etc., to the kinetic energy, the typical thing is the fine structure constant, right? E squared over hc, which tells you how strongly interacting your theory is. Now that is 1 over 137, we all know that. In graphene, everything remains the same, except that this c, the speed of light, is now bigger, is replaced by the Fermi velocity. Because that's the effective velocity of these Dirac particles around the Dirac point. Remember that a Hamiltonian had some vf times something. A typical Dirac thing, you would have c times that structure. Now of course, vf is 10 to the power 6 meters per second of the order, which is 1/100 of the speed of light. Which means that this fine structure, effective fine structure constant is 100 over 137. It's of the order of 0.8 or so. It's not a weakly interacting theory at all. However, it so turns out that there are numerical calculations on lattices, which shows that what this interaction does typically at very strong interactions is to open up this Hubbard gap and make it an insulator. This doesn't happen in graphene. You are still below that critical interaction strength, and therefore that interaction, what it does is to denormalize various quantities in the same way as Fermi liquid theory, but it doesn't do anything beyond that. So band theory, some denormalized band theory, is still a good way of looking into graphene. And it turns out that, okay, so basically what this interaction does is to induce scattering. So imagine that an electron moves along with a momentum k. So if you had a interacting system, what happens is that you would have a scattering from k to k prime. Okay? Because you have an interaction term, so the electrons can just scatter with another electron, and these two can go into different momentum sites. So for each momentum, the quasi-particle has a finite lifetime, because after some time, it is likely to have some scattering and disappear from that momentum. Now, how does that come into picture? That comes into picture because the energy dispersion now has a what is called a self-energy component, which is an imaginary part. And the imaginary part here, if you had an imaginary part out in here, it means typically that it has a finite lifetime. Okay. You can just take a Fourier transform of this and show that the imaginary terms means that this quasi-particle wave function decays in time with some typical time constant. Now this one can calculate and one can show that this happens. And one radical consequence of that, which was of having this kind of self-energy and associated imaginary term, is that the Fermi velocity, which was dear for standard band theory, gets enormous. And the Dirac cone, instead of being a straight line like this, bends, okay, and it has a funny funnel type structure. And this has been actually part of it up to some distance from the Fermi and Dirac point. It has been experimentally verified that the shape is deviating from our straight line. A really sophisticated RTS kind of experiment from Lyons group. So interaction is important, but the basic band theory features are there. Okay? So that's the main point that I think.
But it doesn't matter at the k equals 0.
No, k equals 0, no, it doesn't open up a gap. And the reason that it doesn't open up a gap is that to open up a gap, you need to have pseudo spin asymmetry. In the sense that, you know, so you really mean in the Dirac language a tau 3 matrix or a sigma 3 matrix. The sigma 3 matrix essentially means in this language that there has to be some process which is going to distinguish between your pseudo spin up and pseudo spin down states. So it's like applying a magnetic field to a Dirac system that's going to open up a gap. But this interaction doesn't do that. It's equivalent for A and B submatrix. So this Dirac cone is symmetric protected. So it doesn't open up. So, and graphene has fantastic applications. Since this is an institute of technology, I thought that I'd spend a few slides for this. One of them is a graphene can be used as a gas sensor. And the reason this can happen is that for a sensor, what is important is that the surface to volume ratio has to be large, because it absorbs any gas to a surface. And for graphene, this is one, because it's all surface. So, and it turns out by several of these things, which I don't want to get into the details of, there are some measurements in graphene which can detect 1 parts per billion concentration of adsorbed gas. And this was shown again by Dimes group, essentially. And the way you detect it is that you detect the change of resistivity. Okay? And the reason why this happens is that the density of state is very susceptible to energy changes around the Dirac point. So, in fact, it turns out that extremely close to the Dirac point, you could have a pristine graphene. Adding a single electron would change the resistivity by 2.5 ohms. Now, that's a huge thing. However, of course, you cannot really go that close because, you know, in graphene, there are always imperfections which muddles the physics field on the Dirac point. But nevertheless, people have done these measurements and they could detect 1 parts per billion constant. This is a very, very good sensor. People have tried making transistors out of graphene. And speed was an issue, but you know, people have made progress with that. So, and
so one question is that transistor sensor is itself absorbing the gas, or you just feeding some matrix elements within that?
No, the gas bosons sits on top of graphene, which in turn changes its conductivity.
And this it does universally for all kind of.
No, not universally for all kinds of. So there were some examples that I showed, nitrogen dioxide and stuff like that. You know, that it has to bind.
Stuff which
it has to bind.
Absorb there.
Yeah, it has to be absorbed. I mean, it cannot be just any
electron. Just the electron transfer happens within the graphene.
Oh, I'm not entirely sure how it binds.
Is it changed by adding electron in the graphene?
Yeah. So the point is that, see, what happens is that there has to be an electron transfer process, and that electron transfer process changes the net energy. And because the density of state is very, very sensitive, very close to the Dirac point, you can pick up a very tiny change. So that's why you can detect that. But the real progress that has been made in our particularly in Samsung, in Korea, is that there is the production of very large size of graphene films using some CVD technique, which is different from this caustic technique that I talked about. So it's really vapor deposition, okay? Controlled vapor deposition of this carbon, which essentially gives you this graphene film. And particularly if you have 2 layers of graphene, it turns out that you can apply an electric field to, so you can apply electric field tunable band gap. And then if you put in a photon, you can have emission at a particular wavelength. And this is very good for, extremely good for having LEDs, because it can generate light at a very fixed wavelength. And you know, there has been a lot of progress in making these graphene LEDs. And if this really comes into play in the market in a commercial form, so really, it's really amazing. You can have a TV screen which is going to disappear when it suddenly kind of see a graphene film of, you know, bilayer graphene. It's simply going to disappear. And the other thing which makes it very, very useful is that this LED sheet is would be very, very strong. Because graphene, a single layer or even a bilayer graphene, are some of the strongest materials that you can think of. The interplanar carbon bond is so strong that you can bend it to going.
I cannot stop myself from asking.
Yeah, sure, go ahead.
If you go back to that picture of light cone distortion. Can I model it as a metric, non-trivial metric?
I'm not entirely sure. The way people look into this is that, you see that, so when you put in this self energy, your velocity gets minimized. So this means that there is a spin-dependent renormalization coming from the self-energy, which is essentially renormalizing this Fermi velocity. Now, whether or not that is going to call us a metric is something, and it's not in real space.
No, that's fine.
Yeah. In momentum space, whether, probably not. You know, it's a scalar quantity which is being renormalized out there. Okay, so probably not.
Does it induce curvature there?
That's what I'm asking.
Sorry?
Does it induce curvature at the origin?
That is exactly what I'm asking.
It looks like it does. It's a funnel shape, you know, but I'm not entirely sure. But it doesn't give place to a mass. So del square epsilon del k square at the Dirac point is still zero. Okay, so that's so in that sense it doesn't, but I mean, okay, so now let me switch gears and talk a bit about topological insulators. So, you know, topological insulators are, so in graphene, as I showed, is that the Dirac nature of the low energy quasi particle came from band field. Here, this class of materials, topological insulators, are materials where this comes from, effect of topology in the system. So, I'm not going to give you a full description of this, but I'm going to sort of lead you to it. Let me try to do that. So the first instance where topology came in a big way in condensed matter system, well, not the first instance, but one of the most popular instances, I would say, is conventional quantum modeling. And the reason is that, okay, so let's just try to think about this. So imagine that you have a 2D plane with a perpendicular magnetic field and an electron moves in this magnetic field. So this problem is a really a textbook quantum mechanics problem, and it's analogous to solving a harmonic oscillator. Who already probably done this assignment one way or the other. So apparently these Landau levels, which are the energy levels of this, are just these harmonic oscillator levels. And you see that the wave function is just shifted harmonic oscillator with x going to x minus ky lb squared. This ky is the transverse momentum. Okay, so I choose a gauge where you still keep the transverse momentum component free. And lb squared is the magnetic length. That's the typical length scale associated with the magnetic field that you have. Now the question is that, okay, for a single electron this is all fine, but when there are multiple electrons, you know, I need to put these electrons according to the lowest possible energy configuration, right? So the question is that how many electrons can you put in a given Landau level in this 2D setup? And of course the answer to that is that one per ky, you know, because you have Pauli principle, you really cannot put more than one part ky, up to a factor of 2 because there will be spin up or down. Let's forget about that. So then you would ask yourself, so how many ky modes do I have? Right? And the way to answer that is that you see that for this wave function to have an electron which sits inside the sample, your x coordinate, the shift of this x coordinate must be within plus or minus lx, the dimension of this sample. Because if the x coordinate is shifted larger than this lx, then that's not a valid thing, right? The electron goes out of the sample. So ky lp squared must lie between minus lx by 2 to plus lx by 2, right? Which means that ky, total number of ky states to be occupied is lx by lp squared. So total number of ky lp squared is lx. That's the total number, and so the total ky states is lx by lb squared. So how many states are there? We know that in a sample of dimension ly, this ky is quantized in the mix of 2 pi over ly. So now I can do my math. So 2 2 pi n times divided by LOI must be equal to LX over LB squared, which tells me that the density of step is just 1 over 2 pi LB squared, which in turn tells me that as I increase my magnetic field, the number of available states in a given lambda level keeps on increasing linearly with the magnetic. And then you hit a state, a regime, where at a fixed magnetic field, you have as many number of states in the first lambda level as the number of electrons in your sample. So A is equal to N of B.
So this could be simple.
That's a true sample. Yeah, that is just a true sample. So KZ doesn't come in. And then you can do a simple calculation. So Jx, in terms of presence of this magnetic field, is NE over B by EY. And this is sigma xy times EY. But what is this NE over B? When N is equal to this density of state, you can calculate this, you know, just by putting this formula of density over state and LP. Then you will find that sigma xy is simply E squared over H times the number of lambda levels. And that's your quantized Hall conductance. And of course, why it remains quantized over a range of magnetic field has to do with disorder in the sample. I'm not going to get into that. But the point is that for magnetic field B, for which the density of electrons is n lambda levels, we have an integer field n equal to n. And that integer essentially sits in front of the Hall conductance. The Hall conductance is just that integer n c squared over h. Now, oh, this is just classical analysis. So you apply a magnetic field and there is a current. You try to find out the electrons move in one direction. It's a classical form. Just through the classical Lorentz force thing, this is what works. So then there is this. But this integer quantum Hall effect was interesting because there is something called a ball gauge correspondence, which is central to understanding this concept of topological insulator. So let me explain this in this context. So what happens is that you have a 2D sample and you have a magnetic field. And if I look at the classical picture, inside there are these cyclotron orbits, right? I mean, that's what the electron does when you put in a magnetic field. The radius of this orbit shrinks with increasing magnetic field. In the quantum language, what this means is that the amplitude of the wave function, the wave function of the electrons in the quantum language becomes more and more lower. And this localization length is roughly the radius of this lambda, this cyclotron orbit. However, when you are at the edge, what happens is that these orbits cannot be completed. You know, it gets reflected from the edge, and then it does this, and then this. So the presence of the edge gives you a direction of motion. And these orbits are called skipping orbits. So if you have an edge, the electron tries to do the cyclotron motion, then gets reflected from the edge, and then again does that. And it moves, So the quantum picture of that is in the bulk, you have these localized levels. However, at the edge, because you have a, moving electron, you have a delocalized, you have an energy level which causes the Fermi, which is necessary for giving a finite transport, a current. These are the edge states, and you see that it has a direction, and that's okay because you have already broken time reversal symmetry by putting in a magnetic field. So that gives you the direction of motion of these electrons. And so the picture is that the cyclotron orbits in the bulk corresponds to the localized lambda levels, whereas the skipping orbits at the edge leads to delocalized states at the edge of the sample. And this edge of the sample carries all the time.
What about the top edge?
What top edge? No, it goes like this.
Oh, just through this.
Yeah.
So you have a directionality.
You have a directionality. So it can, for example, it's an exercise to figure out that if it is facing the board of the plane, which direction it would go.
Yeah.
I cannot do that, but the point is I can just tell you that if it goes like this, it's going to follow this one. And so now you come to, so once people understood this, then they thought that, okay, so maybe, can I do this without breaking time reversal symmetry? And the answer to this came through the spin orbit interaction, which essentially tells you that, the spin and the orbital angular momentum of these electrons has some interaction between them. And imagine that, So one can see this, and I don't want to get into the details of this calculation, but it's a very easy two-step calculation to show that this p-normic interaction under certain circumstances can be written as an equivalent to having an effective magnetic field, but in opposite direction for spin up and spin down. Let's just accept this. So, but if this happens, you see, now for spin up, you have some cyclotron orbits and some skipping orbits out here. And for the spin down, you have same cyclotron orbits and skipping orbits, but in opposite direction. So what happens is that two levels essentially crosses the Fermi level from these two skipping orbits. So you have a pair of edge states carrying opposite spin and chiral. So there is no charge transport because one of the edge modes goes this way and the other goes in the other direction, which means your net charge transport is zero. But you have a net spin transport because it's spins moving in opposite direction. So the net spin transport is fine. Okay. Time universal symmetry is preserved. And as long as you don't put in a magnetic interaction, you really cannot induce interaction between the states because you need a scattering matrix element from an up to a down state, which is, I mean, in the absence of magnetic interaction, there is no harm.
Sir, in this case, you have the same material and you are applying the two electrons of magnetic field in this side and this side.
Okay, so first of all, I cheated a bit. I'm not really doing that. What I'm doing is that I'm relying on the fact that some of these materials, 2D materials, for example, have a very strong spin or bit coupling. And then there are a couple of lines of calculation which shows you that, you know, this spin orbit coupling under certain circumstances can be is exactly equivalent mathematically to having a magnetic field up for the up electrons and a magnetic field down for the down electrons. That's just a statement. I will prove it, but if you accept that, then you see the rest of the calculation is exactly same as that of the Hall effect. Just once you have to do it for the up electrons and once you have to do this for the down electrons.
But we have a same material. And
same no, it's not same material. It's a completely different material, except that it's also two-dimensional. Material is could be completely different. For quantum Hall systems, it could be gallium arsenide samples and stuff like that. These materials are different. I mean, graphene can have some properties like that. Some other materials can have that. But not gallium arsenide samples. So the basic property to understand here is that if there is a interesting property in the bulk, you know, that has some consequence for the cage. So this particular phenomenon is known as the bulk cage correspondence, and there are several examples both in field theory and in correspondence where this plays a crucial role. And I think you know, for us, we think of it as safety as one of those, but that is going to enrage all string theories for sure. But the point is that really, I mean, you know, and topological insulators are essentially the 3D counterpart of this bulk cage correspondence. So what happens there, and I'm not going to get into the details of this, it's a special class of 3D band insulators with very strong spin orbit couplings. And because it has this strong spin orbit coupling, like just like in this 2D stuff, there are some topological properties of the bands in the bulk that one can show leads to some gapless electrons at the surface. Just as, you know, in the 2D, the presence of this spin orbit coupling led to some chiral states, here in 3D, it leads to some typical gapless electrons at the surface, and it turns out, and I'm not proving this statement, this has been done by several people out here, that those electrons follow an effective Dirac type of dispersion. And the spin of this Dirac thing is the real spin. So in graphing, this was pseudo spin, but here it's the real spin.
So why do they call it topological insulator? Just because
the reason is that it's an insulator. So insulator because it's an insulating material.
Yeah.
Topological because these bands has some topological properties.
Light.
And this, sorry.
So like which kind of properties?
Well, okay. So if you calculate that, so that is described in terms of the charge number of these bands. And then from those bulk charge numbers, you can do a projection on the surface, which leads to some properties. You can show that there are some gaplesses. We can talk about this after the talk. So there also you do exactly the same calculation. It's really this TKNL formula which you apply to this
parameter. What is the winding number of the
Exactly. So this winding number, there is a way to extend that to, and that's what this guy is found actually. So essentially, why it is interesting is that it gives you the first tabletop experimental setup for starting properties of DRSP in C++1. And the difference with graphing is that here, you can have a single data phone on a given surface. Whereas in graphing, you always have. And here are some experiments. So you see clearly that in RPS experiments, so you measure this angle reader photo emission spectroscopy. So for the students, this is a, you just put in a photon in, and that photon knocks out an electron. By studying the, that photon knocks out an electron, and by knowing the energy and the momentum of the photons that you have put in, and by studying the property of this electron, you know exactly from where in the Fermi surface, you know, or how much below the Fermi surface that electron has been knocked out. Doing this systematically, you can chart out the Fermi surface in the middle. So that's what they use. And you see these cones. Okay? So these are these typical Dirac-like cones. And the other thing that they have seen is that the spin of this, and I'm not going to explain this, but what they saw and what was the clinching argument for this being really a topological insulator is that the spin of this electrons which are coming out from different points on the Fermi surface are pointing along a fixed direction. And this is essentially your spin momentum coupling, or the property of helicity, which is there for the electron. So let me just try to explain that in a minute. Okay, so, but before that, so now I'm going to switch gears and talk about transport properties of this Dirac fermion in some very small context. So the first thing, and this is really what the students know, is that if you have a barrier and you have this nightmare homework problem where you are allowed to calculate, asked to calculate the transmission through this barrier, for Schrodinger electrons, essentially it tells you that even if the incident electron has an energy which is less than the barrier, there is a finite probability that it's going to go through. Now this is completely in contrast to your classical intuition, where if you throw a ball at the wall, as long as the ball hits the whole of it comes back. It's not that you get part of the ball and the rest channels through. But in quantum mechanics that happens. And quantum mechanics allows for a process to even channel through. The basic point in this kind of situation is that for potential much, much greater than the energy, the transmission is a monotonically decreasing function of the dimensionless barrier strength. So if you construct a barrier of height V0 and D, you can construct a dimensionless barrier strength like this. So it's forget about this in here, it's V0 times V over some H times typical velocity. Dimensionless barrier strength. And if you increase this, your transmission is going to increase. So that's the other thing. Now in Dirac theory, that seems very logical. And Dirac theory, that logic completely goes out of the window. So now here is a homework problem. So you know what this Hamiltonian is, it's just sigma dot k. Just solve the same transmission problem which you did for your second year quantum mechanics course. And you find that the transmission is now an oscillatory function of this barrier strength. So that's the form of this transmission. And here gamma is the angle at which this electron hits the barrier. And that's given by this. It's ky over tan inverse of ky over k. So this is the angle that, so if you have a barrier like this, you know, you can hit it straight, or you can hit it at an angle, right? And that angle is gamma. And this chi is the dimensionless vertex. So two very weird properties out here. The first one is that if gamma is zero, which means in my language, that means that you keep the barrier normal. Transmission becomes 1 irrespective of this barrier strength. It's a paradoxical result. No matter how high a barrier you put, your electron just goes through. And that phenomenon is known as a Klein paradox. So Klein, right after Dirac wrote down his equation, pointed out that there is this paradoxical result for Dirac electrons going through a barrier. Now this is one sequence. So there is a way to understand this. And that is something that I'm going to come back after I discuss this helicity property. So let me stop here. The other thing, which is again very interesting property, is that if chi, this barrier strength, becomes integer multiple of pi, if chi is equal to n pi, you see that this cos square factor becomes 1, and then the transmission again becomes 1. So there are special values of this barrier, which could be large, by the way, because chi equal to n could be for large n could be very large, allows for complete transmission of this electron through the barrier for any angle of incidence. So the basic point is that transmission is an oscillatory function of the dimensionless barrier strength, and it is qualitatively different physics from that of Schrödinger. So that's one thing. The second thing about this thing is the helicity of this layer. So let me think of a Hamiltonian of a Dirac electron and surface of a tubular insulator. This is almost like sigma dot k. Okay, it's just sigma x now couples to ky and vice versa, rather than sigma x coupling to k, but it's really the same. But now it's a two-way matrix, right? I can diagonalize this and find out its eigenvalues and eigenvectors. The eigenvalues are of course this linear Dirac dispersion that you find. The eigenvectors is 1 and then this particular thing out here. And theta is the angle at which the electron moves in momentum space. But now look at the case where, let's say the electron is moving along y. Then you see that kx is certainly 0. Which means that theta is pi by 2, because this goes to, right? And you just put this out here, okay? E to the power I pi by 2, etc. And you find that this u k v k is 1, 1. And that's an eigenstate of sigma x, right? 1, 1, as we all know, is an eigenstate of sigma x. As a result, what it means is that the spin of the electron points along x when the electron moves along y. But you can do this with any theta, and you would see that with this Hamiltonian, the spin of the electron always points perpendicular to the direction of motion. Okay? If you had a sigma dot k here, the spin would be pointing along the direction. It's at a fixed angle, no matter what, but I mean. So the point that, so for this gapless Dirac formulas, essentially what happens is that the spin of these are tied to its direction of motion, and that's a classic property of helicity, which we know from particle physics. If you have a gapless property, it has a helicity. Well, neutrinos were good candidates before their masses came up, but I mean, it doesn't hold for massive particles. So, okay.
The problem is that, okay, so for gapless, by a few things we call it massless.
That's it, for massless particles.
Here, there is no Lorentz invariance.
Yes, sorry, what?
There is no Lorentz invariance.
No, but there is an effective Lorentz symmetry around the Q point. Because you have a linear dispersion, you can write down an effective action, and that will have Lorentz symmetry.
Otherwise, these properties are defined.
Of course, if you look at an electron which you are way above out there, then you are not going to see this property. Because there are band bending and all kinds of things. But near the Dirac point, this is. So it's an emergent symmetry, so to speak. So around a particular Dirac point, additional symmetry emerges. So this can happen, right? I mean, so if you have a theory, there are maybe special points in parameter space where which is more symmetric compared to the other. This is just an example.
Sorry? Has there been any experiments on the tunneling?
I'll come to that actually. Just a minute. For time tunneling, you mean?
Yeah.
Oh. For client tunneling, the problem is that you have to really have collimated transport because you only have to pick up ky, normal transmission. That's very hard in experiments. It's not simple. So people have looked into the angle dependence and they kind of match what the client result would be. But that this unit transmission when it goes perpendicular to the barrier, that hasn't been experimented in graphene. That's right.
Let's say keep on changing the tunneling barrier.
No. That's transmission resonance. That's not
transmission resonance.
There have been suggestions. People haven't been able to ease this. So these barriers of making this thing. But there have been lots of theoretical suggestions that this could be done. I mean, the original one came from Barry's group, and then other people have also worked on this. And now let me try to explain Klein paradox using this helicity property. And one way to see this is that imagine that this electron goes out here, it has a fixed direction of spin, let's say along y. Okay. Now, if this barrier is to deflect this electron, it has also to flip its spin. But look, this barrier is not a magnetic barrier. It doesn't have any structure in spin space, it's a scalar barrier. And you know, scalar barriers cannot keep spin on scattering. That's a basic point, right? It doesn't have a requisite matrix element. So when an electron approaches perpendicular to the barrier doesn't have any choice but to let the electron go through. And that's one way, essentially, to understand Klein paradox. In context of graphene, the spin has to be just substituted by single spin. And that's the... And the third property, which I would like to point out, is what happens when you put in a magnetic field in graphene. Now the point is that if I put in a magnetic, topological insulator. So imagine that this is a topological insulator surface and I have a Dirac signature. And I put in a magnetic field, let's say along y. Now since it's a two-dimensional surface and I'm putting a magnetic field parallel to the surface, there is no orbital. And the way to see this is that I can write this magnetic field in terms of some Az, right? The vector potential could be a, you can choose a gauge which is effectively an Az. And then there is nothing that couples to that vector potential from an orbital point. But in quantum mechanics, you still have the Zeeman term, spins to couple to magnetic fields, right? And so you have a sigma dot b. But this topological insulator has already had a term which is like sigma y kx. And now that term essentially becomes sigma y times kx minus this quantity. Okay. It's just sigma y times b. But this means that all you have done for constant b is to shift your kx by a constant amount. That's like applying a constant gauge field, which doesn't change anything. Right? A constant gauge field cannot change any tangible property of the system. And therefore, a constant magnetic field doesn't do any change whatsoever. However, if this magnetic field varies in space, then its curve is taken as a fictitious magnetic field by the electrons out here. Because this applied magnetic field acts as a vector potential. And so if it has a finite curve for this graphene or topological insulator electron, that's like having a proper magnetic field which is going to curve its motion and do stuff. So this is one big difference with Schrodinger electrons.
So you take your magnetic field, you separate it into divergence p and curl p part.
That's right.
So the curl p part does not contribute. Is that what you
mean? That's it. And the curl p part is not going to contribute because...
Just a minute.
Yeah. Okay, any other question regarding this?
In the last slide, you said that when the sigma is in x direction, then electron goes in y direction when there is sigma cross k.
That's right.
And when there is sigma dot k, then they are
in then they are the same thing. And in that case, if you work out this helicity, what you will find is that
my question is that when they will make a helix, because when there is
it cannot see you either have a sigma cross k dot z, or you have a sigma dot k. Sigma dot k works in graphene. Sigma cross k dot dz works in topological instruments. So that's the two possibilities that you would have.
But they will not make a helix.
Helix means what?
Helicity will be there or not?
No, helicity works because as the direction of motion changes, the direction of spin also changes. That's the helicity property. It's not a helix in real space or in quantum space. Is this clear? I mean, you move an electron along this, its point, spin is always going to point like this. It just goes like this. You move it back, the spin is also going to flip. So the essential point is that the spin is tied to the direction of motion. And that property is termed as a helicity. Okay. So it's a standard when you study field theory. That's the way helicity is defined.
So
the
eigenstate of helicity?
Yeah, it will remain as an eigenstate of this. It's an operator whose eigenstate, which quantum number is conserved. Okay, so how much time do I have? 5 minutes?
Yeah.
5 minutes, right? So I'm going to keep this transport property of graphene junction. I'm just going to talk about some transport property in the topological insulator junction, which shows this property of this applied magnetic field.
Let me skip a lot of slides.
So junctions of topological insulators. And so this is one of the works that we did. So essentially, we wanted to look into this. So this is a topological insulators junction, okay? And we have a, so what we did is to deposit a magnetic material out here. Just look at the left figure. And this magnetic material has a magnetization. And because it's deposited right on the top of a graphene surface, or sorry, topological insulator surface, it induces a magnetization in the region directly below. Induces a magnetization in the region directly below the this EL. So in other words, here the direct electron doesn't have any magnetization. Here it also doesn't have anything. But in between, it does have a magnetization. What does this magnetization do? It provides a term which is like sigma dot b, some sigma dot m. So in this regime, you know, it's the wave vector of these electrons now go to, just as I showed, k times, so k goes to k minus m, okay, because there is a sigma dot m. Now of course, you know, because it's a constant m, this doesn't do anything, except at the edge of the of this region, where this magnetization decays. And because it decays, that's a special dependent stuff. Okay? And that is effectively like having a magnetic field up in this direction and down in the, so let me just show you. So this is my, this is, so here is what I do, and what the electron sees is that in this regime it doesn't see anything, because you have just shifted its momentum by some m. The magnetization abruptly drops at the edge of these two regions, and because of this drop, the electrons perceive this change. And to this change in magnetization appears to the electrons as an effective magnetic field, because this magnetization now has a curl. So it points along y and it changes in space along x, which means that it has a finite curl. And as a result, this effective magnetic field is perceived at the edge of this region. Now think of putting an electron through a current. What does it do? It does something very interesting. So in this region of some finite length, you know, if you put in electron out here, the trajectory of the electron just curves a little bit. But it ultimately hits the other edge, where, you know, and then it straightens out and moves up. So that's what. However, if you now increase this magnetization, the bending that the electron has through this region could be large enough so that it really cannot go to this other region, but it just bends back. Right? So this tells you, this simple classical picture tells you that there is a critical strength of magnetization beyond which current through this region is going to be cut. So this particular geometry can act as a magnetic switch. Change magnetization and you shut off current in a given junction. So this is magnetic control over electric current, you know, which is one of those possibilities in spintronics that people look at. Yeah, but the critical magnetization is the magnetization at which all k vectors is, I mean, the bending is strong enough so that all k vectors just does this. Because otherwise there will be a finite current. So as you increase this magnetization, your current is going to decrease. And when you reach that critical thing, no matter at what k vector the electron approaches, it's simply going to bend. And this can be shown by a standard quantum mechanical calculation. But I'm not going to go to the details of this, but the only thing that I'm going to point out is that for those of you who are familiar with this standard transport calculation in quantum mechanics, the longitudinal momentum in region 2 is essentially the energy minus the transverse momentum. Right? But now this transverse momentum, because you have this magnetization in region 2, is ky plus m. So you see that if you make m large enough, you're going to, for any energy, you are simply going to make this imaginary, which essentially means no transport, because imaginary kx means that there is no transport on the no current. So, and we can find out a critical magnetization, and you know, there are some nice pictures that one has. So here is the thing that this z is some effective magnetization, forget about it. So for small z, you have this oscillatory transport out here, okay, but beyond this critical zone, you see that the magnetization is just. So, and this is not only with one such medium, you can put multiple such medium. The property remains the same, except the oscillations become a lot more complicated because now your scattering is from a lot more term. But the basic physics remains the same. And the point is here is that the basic thing that is behind this possible switching effect, you know, the magnetic switching of this electron current, is essentially a property of bigger things. That it has a, so if you have a sigma dot k kind of Hamiltonian, just by putting in a parallel magnetization or magnetic field, you can have this effect. This is never going to be seen in Schrodinger electrons because, you know, Zeeman energy doesn't act in the same way as, you know. So this is something that we think. The other thing that is interesting in this case is that there is other ways of, so if you take a electron and connect it to, so surface of a topological insulator and connect it to a standard metal, there are ways like where you can push in spin currents from this. And the reason is very simple. Imagine that there is a barrier between a topological insulator surface, which is a Dirac particle, and a standard metal. Now this Dirac particle goes and hits the barrier, okay? Gets reflected and some of it gets transmitted. However, when it gets reflected, so imagine that it was going with some spin in some particular direction. When it gets reflected, because its motion changes, its spin gets redistributed in different states. The scattering state which goes forward and the reflected state which goes back. And this redistribution of spin essentially means that the charge current that you put in also has a finite spin current that goes in. So spin transport is another thing which is very interesting in this kind of material. We did work on this a bit, but I don't want to get into the details of this. I'm anyway out of time. So let me just conclude. So over the last 10 years or so, we have seen that there is a large class of materials where the basic quasi-particles, the low-energy quasi-particles, obey Dirac-like rather than Schrodinger-like physics. And this gives us the first tabletop setup where you can actually, after probably now, what, 19 years maybe, of writing down this equation, this is the first experimental setup that you can, where you can really probe Dirac physics. Standard QED you cannot, because you know the you always have these photons which are going to completely screw up with this basic properties. So this is one place where you can see such properties. And it turns out that this is also the first time where we have an opportunity of studying what happens when you put strong interaction of electrons with Dirac physics. So it's a combination of strong interaction and Dirac stuff. So it has, and it turns out that it has very interesting properties in terms of quantum physics. So if you put a magnetic impurity of this Dirac thing, what happens? The behavior is completely different from Schrodinger electron. It has very different properties from transport physics, where, you know, one thing I have shown you, and there are other properties of this. So it's a very exciting time where these kinds of properties, which are very basic, which follows from very basic Dirac equations, can be seen in the field of experiments and completely. So I think I'm going to stop here. Thank you for your attention.